Welcome to the NTEB Radio Bible Study with your host and Bible teacher, Jeffrey Greider. Rightly divided, dispensationally correct, and standing on the authority of the King James Holy Bible, this program is brought to you by NowTheEndBegins.com.
And good evening, everyone, and welcome to the Sunday night edition of Rightly Dividing. My name is Jeff Greider. I am the editor-in-chief of NowTheEndBegins.com. And tonight, I have the honor and the privilege of being your radio host and Bible teacher. Let's go to the Lord in prayer and ask for his blessing on tonight's program. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your goodness and we thank you for your mercy. Lord, we just commit this entire time to you. We commit the music and the testimonies and the people that we'll be praying for. And most of all, the time where we're going to open up your word and we're going to look to see what you would have us to understand, Father God. And we ask you to give us fresh light on your written revelation, Lord. Everything from Genesis to the end of Revelation. And we love you, God, and we trust you. And Lord, I just pray a specific prayer for everybody listening tonight, Lord, that they would get a blessing from this, that this wouldn't just be seen as entertainment or a fun Christian thing to do on a Sunday night. No, that this is a Bible study. And God, I thank you so much for all the people that you bring in here from all over the world. I thank you so much, Lord, that the people who come here really want to learn something. And so, Father God, I just lift up everybody tonight and I ask you, Lord, to open all of our ears and all of our eyes to your word and just rain it down upon us, God. We know that we're living in the end times. We know. And tonight, what a big, big topic, the days of Noah. Father God, make it new, make it fresh. And we just put this all in your hands and ask for your blessing, Father God. In Jesus' name, amen.
And all of the angels cry.
Now that's what I call getting off to a good rousing start for our Sunday night program. If you're just tuning in, tonight's topic, Genesis 6 Giants, the Days of Noah, and the soon coming pre-tribulation rapture of the church. A lot of people have been asking me if I've been feeling better. And yes, I am. And thank you so much for all your prayers and your concerns. I just, for the last couple of weeks, I've just had a really nasty, persistent, upper respiratory, I don't know, infection, whatever you want to call it, but it just, sapped me of a lot of my energy, and it was hard to talk. Last week's show, 2 weeks ago, was hard to do. I kept running out of air, but I'm feeling better. So thank you so much for all of your prayers. Tonight's topic, we're talking about the Genesis 6 Giants, the Days of Noah, and the soon coming pre-tribulation rapture of the church. So how are all these things connected? Well, that's what we're going to be talking about tonight. On this episode of Rightly Dividing, we will pay a visit to the Genesis 6 giants, the Nephilim and the Rephaim, in the days of Noah, because they're getting ready to make a reappearance in our day. How do I know that? Because Jesus in Matthew 24 says that the coming time of Jacob's trouble, which contains the Great Tribulation on the back half of those 7 years, will be just like it was in the days of Noah. Luke expands on that. Luke says, yeah, it's going to be like the days of Noah, but it's also going to be like the days of Lot. And there's a reason Luke wasn't just repeating himself. Luke wasn't just trying to throw Lot in so he'd have something more to say than Matthew did. There's a reason why Luke adds the days of Lot, and we're going to be looking at that. The days of Noah was many things. It was the giants. It was fallen angels fornicating with human women. It was a worldwide flood, and it was Enoch, who is a perfect type of the pre-tribulation rapture of the church. Now, as usual, because I dared to mention the pre-tribulation rapture in this context, I have been getting nasty comments all day long. But that's just fine, because the pre-tribulation rapture of the church is Bible doctrine. And guess what? I've never read anything by John Nelson Darby. I've never read anything by Mary MacDonald. I had a Scofield Reference Bible for a short period of time when I first got saved. For years and years and years now, I've had a Ruckman Reference Bible. But guess what? I don't need any commentary to show me that the Bible teaches a pre-tribulation rapture of the church. That is not something that you need a commentary for. I wrote an article called "It Is High Time That We Considered the Pre-Tribulation Rapture of the Born-Again Church to Be One of the Essential Doctrines of the Faith." And we're going to be talking about that tonight. We're going to be talking about that in coming weeks. The Bible, make no mistake about it, the Bible teaches a pre-tribulation rapture of the church. It's not opinion. It's not, well, I believe what I believe and you have your thoughts and we'll agree to disagree. No, the Bible absolutely teaches emphatically and declaratively a pre-tribulation rapture of the church. Now, you will notice whenever you hear me talk about the pre-tribulation rapture, I always add the words of the church, because there is more than one rapture. And that's what we're going to be looking at tonight. It's a big topic. I love talking about the Genesis 6 giants. I love talking about the days of Noah and the time of Jacob's trouble. But more than anything, I love talking about the pre-tribulation rapture of the church, because that's where you and I are going to get out. And it's just, for me, it's exciting. And I hope that it's exciting for you as well.
I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus.
I told you guys all through 2019 that it was my feeling, it was my hunch, it was my intuition, whatever you want to call it, that 2020 was going to be a crazy, off the charts type of year. And we are approximately 5 weeks and 2 days into 2020, and things have absolutely been off the charts. We had the possibility of World War III starting between the United States and Iran. We had Nancy Pelosi ripping up Trump's speech. It's just the coronavirus killing hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of people. The original doctor who talked about and warned people about the virus died, and China tried to cover it up. Israel is getting ready to start annexing Judea and Samaria in accordance with the Trump peace plan, which the Palestinians absolutely hate. But man, oh man, it's been a crazy, crazy year, and we're only 5 weeks into it. And now theendbegins.com is with you every step of the way. We had a fantastic month of January. Let me just give you a few stats to go with that. We had over 1.12 million views of our web pages, which is fantastic. We are ranked 31,000 in the entire world. We have an average of just under 19,000 unique visitors per day. And we are ranked around 6,000 in the United States. And get this, on average, people coming to Now the End Begins are spending an average of 40 minutes per day on our site, reading the Bible teaching and reading the articles and all these things. And I just praise God for that. You know, a lot of the times people will ask me, I don't have any money. I can't support your fundraiser. I'm not really good at praying. What can I do to support NowTheEndBegins.com? Well, one of the best ways that you can support this ministry is to share the links to our articles and our pages on a daily basis on your social media, through text messaging on your phones and your mobile devices and pads and things like that. Share our links as much as you possibly can, because the more people that come and visit the site, the stronger that this ministry gets. So if you can't pray for us, if you can't support the fundraiser, if you can't afford to buy the gospel tracts, you can absolutely take a few minutes out of your day and share our links with your friends across social media, and you have no idea what that does for our site. And that is an excellent way that you can support Now the End Begins. And speaking of our website, on a weekly basis, I am adding new categories to the navigation bar. For example, if you were to go to Bible study, hover over Bible doctrine, you will see that there is now a section for Mystery Babylon. There is now a new section for the time of Jacob's trouble. There is a new section for Matthew 24 articles. So please check out the navigation bar. And we have dozens and dozens and dozens of categories. It's taken me almost a year to build all these things. So please take the time, go through the navigation bar, go click on our links and see what we have. We have over 7,500 articles that we've written over the last 10 years. And every week I am adding a new category to make it easier for people to get their hands on content that we've already written so they can refresh their memory and so that they can grab those links and they can share it with their friends. So please check out what's new on nowtheendbegins.com, and we'll be starting with our Bible study in 9 minutes. So stay with us.
When the trumpet of the Lord shall sound, and time shall be no more, and the morning breaks eternal right and fair, and the saints of earth shall gather over on the other shore, and the roll is called up yonder of the dead.
Called up yonder, I'll be there, as the old song goes. The question is, will you be there every single day. Over 151,000 people die every single day. I shared with you guys last summer my childhood best friend, a man by the name of Dan. I grew up with him. His one sister taught me how to play the violin. His other sister taught me how to play the piano. His family and my family, very, very well connected. His parents and my parents were best friends. Him and I were the same age. And he celebrated his birthday last August by going on a tubing adventure up in Pennsylvania. He didn't feel well. He stepped out of his tube, clutched his chest, fell to the ground, and stepped out into eternity. And I really don't know whether he was saved or lost. We had lost touch years ago. But there's my childhood best friend, and he died. Elwood, our brother Elwood, he was here back in June, and we were preaching on the streets of St. Augustine and handing out gospel tracts together. And Elwood has gone home to be with the Lord. You don't know. It could be your time tomorrow. It could be your time tonight. We just don't know. And that's why we put such an emphasis on our NTEB gospel tracts. At the bottom of every article that we produce, we have a section at the bottom of every single page for you to order a box of our gospel tracts, which helps to support this ministry, but it gets you handing out gospel tracts and telling the lost people about Jesus where you live. And we send out thousands and thousands and thousands of gospel tracts every single month, and we get excited about that. And when people write to us and they say, I would love a box of your gospel tracts, but I can't afford to buy them. If you can't afford to buy a box of gospel tracts, send me an email with your name and address. Send it to info@nowtheendbegins.com, and we'll send you a box of tracts at no charge. We'll send you a King James Bible at no charge. We want the gospel to get out. That is our soul. We're here to evangelize the lost. We are here to warn the lost. We're here to get the saved people back in the game and to get people excited. I don't believe that a revival is going to break out nationally or even globally before the rapture of the church, but you can get revived. You can get excited. You can start preaching and teaching the gospel and handing out gospel tracts in the town where you live. And there's no excuse. That's what we're called to do. Paul tells Timothy, preach the word, be instant in season, out of season. Well, the question is, are you? Are you instant in season, out of season? Are you always prepared? Well, that's what the Bible says that we're supposed to be. So get yourself a box of gospel tracts. If you can't afford them, we'll send you a box at no charge. But we get excited when it's time to talk about sharing the gospel with lost people. And we get excited when it comes time to teaching the Bible. If you are just tuning in, tonight's topic, Genesis 6 giants, the days of Noah, the days of Lot, and the soon coming pre-tribulation rapture of the church. So you better get ready for it. You better get ready. You better get ready.
One day, Jesus is coming. You may be at church. You may be at work. You may be asleep. God grant that you will be ready when he makes his personal appearance. My God, what if his appearance occurs on a Sunday morning? My prophetic word to you this morning is get ready! Get ready!
Yevarechecha Adonai v'yishmerecha. Ya'er Adonai panav elecha v'yichuneka. Yisa Adonai panav elecha v'yasem lecha shalom.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace.
Heavenly Father, we come before you one more time and ask for your blessing on tonight's program. If there be those people, Lord, who seek to disrupt and to stop this program, if it's people or spirits or unseen forces that would seek to come against this program in any way, Lord, we ask for your protection. We ask you to set a hedge about the software and the hardware and my voice and everybody who's listening and the machines that they're listening to it on. And just, Lord, give us 90 minutes in your word tonight, Father God. And just bless it to us, Lord. We believe it. We receive it. And Lord, make it new and make it fresh, and we'll give you all the honor and all the glory in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. I had said to the lovely souls in the chat room a little bit earlier, as this program continues to grow, and we have over 100 people in the chat room right now, please keep your comments during the Bible teaching time, which is from the bottom of the first hour to the end of the second hour, 90 minutes. Please keep the comments centered on the Bible teaching that's being discussed, because I look at the chat and I'm always looking for people who have questions. I'm always looking for people who have insightful comments. And if there's a lot of extra chat, I love the spirit in the chat room. I love how we've become one big global NTEB family. I love that. To me, that thrills my heart like you can't believe. But if we could just, during the Bible teaching section, if we could just keep the comments limited to what we're talking about from the scripture, so I can not get confused when, because, you know, it's funny. A lot of people, they listen to the program, they come to the website, and they think that there's a whole staff of people running this website, and there's not. I write the content. I have a couple of other writers who are very, very good, and they contribute some content. I have Lori and Jeanette and Jerry and a number of other people on Facebook who are very, very helpful. Jeanette is posting all the scripture verses, and she kind of watches out in the chat room, and other people who are doing that as well. We have Brother Harmon over at Pastor Lawson's church in Tennessee, who is putting all of our stuff on sermon audio. So there absolutely are people who help with different aspects of it. But when it comes to doing the show, I don't have a producer. I don't have a control room. It's just me in front of my computer with a microphone and the equipment that your generous giving has bought for this ministry. So I have to kind of look at everything. So if you could just keep the comments during the Bible teaching focused on the Bible teaching, that would really help me out a lot. So thank you. Thank you so very much for that. So we are talking tonight about the Genesis 6 giants, the days of Noah, and the soon coming pre-tribulation rapture of the church. Everybody has an opinion on the giants of Genesis chapter 6. A lot of people feel very, very strongly about what they believe about it. I have people who contact me who say, absolutely, it is just regular people having regular children with women, and they turned out to be bad people. I have people who believe what the Bible teaches about the fallen angels and they're cohabitating with human women. But then even in that section, a lot of people get really crazy with a lot of theories and really go off on the deep end. So tonight, what I want to do is I want to demystify the Genesis 6 giants, and I want to show you, remember, the name of this program is called Rightly Dividing. Everything that we teach has to do with Paul's command in 2 Timothy 2:15, which is, study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman who needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. I feel so strongly about that that I renamed the program 5 years ago to be called Rightly Dividing, because you have to know how to rightly divide. And when you do that, everything just kind of magically falls into place. Now, a number of people in the chat room tonight are asking about the book of Enoch. Everybody wants to know, because we're going to be talking about Enoch tonight. Enoch was a biblical character. We find Enoch in Genesis chapter 5, and everybody knows the story about Enoch, that he was a good man and he was a righteous man, and God loved Enoch. And we read in Genesis chapter 5, verses 23 and 24, and all the days of Enoch were 365 years, and Enoch walked with God, and he was not, for God took him. So there you have the first rapture in the Bible, Enoch being translated from earth to heaven by God. So there is a book, not part of the Bible, called the Book of Enoch. People ask me about this book, just like they ask about the, what is it, the lost gospel of Thomas, and there's a number of other what they call the lost books. And let me just say this about the Book of Enoch, the Gospel of Thomas, and the other quote-unquote lost books of the Bible. There are no lost books of the Bible. If you have a King James Bible in front of you, you have everything that God wrote, that God preserved, that God wants you to know. So we will be spending exactly 0 minutes studying the Book of Enoch, the Gospel of Thomas, the Dead Sea Scrolls. Those things are interesting, and there may be a couple of nuggets scattered in there in some way, but this is the Bible study program, and we will not be entering in the Apocrypha or the Gospel of Thomas or the Shepherd of Herodias or the lost book of, is there a Gospel of Judas? I think there is, and the Book of Enoch. So we really, honestly, we really don't care about those books, because God did not see fit to put them into the Bible. Paul talks about a letter that he wrote to the Laodicean church, and that letter does not exist. And we know that the Apostle Paul wrote it because he says that he wrote it, and he references his letter to the Laodiceans. But when you look in your New Testament, you do not find Paul's letter to the Laodiceans. Why? Because God didn't want it in the book. So on this program, we will always be talking about the Bible, the King James Holy Bible. It says in Ecclesiastes 8:4, where the word of a king is, there is power. And we have the word of a king, and we have power. The Bible says that God has preserved his word. And if you have a King James Bible, you have all the Bible that God wants you to have. Somebody just referenced something called the Sefer Bible, C-E-P-H-E-R Bible translation. I do not recommend it. It is not good. It is connected with the Hebrew Roots movement, which is a cultic movement. The people in the Hebrew Roots movement are not Hebrews. They are not Christians. They don't want you to be a Christian, and they're there to steal your Christianity. The Sefer Bible wants to teach you about the secret sacred names. There are no secret sacred names. The Bible, the King James Bible, that is what we are here to discuss. The Sefer Bible has 13 other books that somebody considers to be inspired. The Book of Jasher, the Book of Enoch, the Book of Jubilees, the Dead Sea Scrolls, and all of those things don't have anything to do with the Bible. So when you come to this program here, you will always get God's Holy Word, the King James Bible, from cover to cover, from Genesis 1 to Revelation chapter 22, and everything in between. We will rightly divide and be dispensationally correct, just like it says on our opening 30-second intro, that we rightly divide and we are dispensationally correct. So we are not concerned with any versions of the Book of Enoch, the Gospel of Thomas, the Dead Sea Scrolls, none of those things have any interest for us. But what we are interested in is in the book that God has preserved, Ecclesiastes 8:4, where the word of a king is, there is power. And who may say unto him, what doest thou? So I hope that that kind of sets the table for tonight's program. And look, I got saved 29 years ago with a King James Holy Bible that was put in a hotel room that my dad took, and he brought it home, and it sat unopened for almost 20 years. And one day, the Holy Spirit woke me up at midnight, had me crack open that book, and I got saved on a King James Bible. And for 29 years, I have used the King James Bible. I have believed it. I have stood on it. I consider it to be God's authorized, holy, preserved word. And as long as I run this program, I will never teach or preach from any other version except from the authorized King James Holy Bible. So I just felt that that needed to be said. Angela has a question before we get started in Genesis 6:3, my spirit, and the Lord said, my spirit shall not always strive with man, for that he also is flesh, yet his days shall be 120 years. And that was the years of man in the days before the flood. After the flood, they got knocked down to, the on average, 70 years. And if you look, the average death age for men in America and around the world is 72 years old. The average death age for women is 77. And here we are 6,000 years later. The Bible says on average, men live to be 70. They're living to 72. 6,000 years later, I think that's pretty good. So with that, let's get started talking about tonight's program. I believe that's enough table setting. And let's get right into tonight's topic, the Genesis 6 giants, the days of Noah, and the soon coming pre-tribulation rapture of the church. So let's turn to Matthew 24. Turn to Matthew 24 in your Bibles, please. Matthew 24 in your Bibles. Now, we've spoken about Matthew 24 dozens and dozens, and I almost want to say hundreds of times, but that may or may not be true. But we have absolutely spoken about Matthew 24 scores and scores of times. I have an article called Our Top 5 Reasons Why Matthew 24 cannot be talking about the pre-tribulation rapture of the church. I just put that into the chat room. If you're not in the chat room, you can go to nowtheendbegins.com, go to the Bible study section, go into the pre-trib rapture section, and you'll see it right at the top on the right-hand side. Matthew 24 is talking about the Jews in the time of Jacob's trouble, leading into the time of the Great Tribulation. Now remember, Jacob's trouble is a 7-year period. We know that from Daniel 9:27, where it talks about the last 7-year week that remains unfulfilled. And people say to me all the time, it says, well, when I read the New Testament, all I see is a 3.5-year period. So the tribulation is only 3.5 years, not 7 years, and that is not true. Because the tribulation is the second half of the time of Jacob's trouble. In Jeremiah 30, verse 7, we read this: alas, for that day is great. It is even the time of Jacob's trouble, yet he shall be saved out of it. That is a 7-year period according to Daniel 9:27. Now, that first 3.5-year period is referenced not by a number, but by the event. Turn to 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. But of the times of the and seasons, brethren, ye have no need that I write unto you. For yourselves know perfectly that the day of the Lord so cometh as a thief in the night. For when they shall say peace and safety, then sudden travail... Then sudden destruction cometh upon them as travail upon a woman with child, and they shall not escape. So the first half of the time of Jacob's trouble is a time of false peace and false safety. Paul in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, turn there now. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, this period of time is called the strong delusion. And it happens after the rapture of the church. Look in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, starting in verse 8. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, starting in verse 8. And then shall that wicked be revealed, whom the Lord shall consume with the spirit of his mouth and shall destroy with the brightness of his coming, even him whose coming is after the working of Satan with all power and signs and lying wonders, and with all deceivableness of unrighteousness in them that perish, because they receive not the love of the truth that they might be saved. And for this cause God shall send them strong delusion that they should believe a lie. And what's the lie? The lie is that Antichrist is the Messiah. Turn to Revelation chapter 5. Turn to Revelation chapter 5. We have been here many times too. This is the chapter where the Apostle John, he's been taken up in chapter 4 in a beautiful type of the pre-tribulation rapture. And here in chapter 5, he's standing before the throne and he sees Daniel's book from Daniel 12 with the seven seals and it's closed. Look at the first 5 verses of Revelation 5. Revelation 5, 1 through 5. And I saw in the right hand of him that sat on the throne a book written within and on the backside, sealed with 7 seals. And I saw a strong angel proclaiming with a loud voice, who is worthy to open the book and to loose the seals thereof? And no man in heaven, nor in earth, neither under the earth, was able to open the book, neither to look thereon. And I wept much, because no man was found worthy to open and to read the book, neither to look thereon. And one of the elders saith unto me, weep not, behold, The Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David, has prevailed to open the book and to loose the seven seals thereof. So this is the book that in Daniel chapter 12, Daniel was told to close and to shut up until the time of the end. And now here it is in Revelation chapter 5, it's the time of the end. And Jesus opens that book, and look what happens in Revelation 6, verses 1 and 2. Revelation 6, verses 1 and 2. And I saw when the Lamb opened one of the seals, and I heard, as it were, the noise of thunder, one of the four beasts saying, "Come and see." And I saw, and behold, a white horse, and he that sat on him had a bow, and a crown was given unto him, and he went forth conquering and to conquer. So, the time of the Great Tribulation is a 3.5 year time period. It is the second half. It's what follows after the first 3.5 years of the phony peace and safety that Antichrist is going to bring. And remember, I told you last week or 2 weeks ago that the Jews make that covenant that the Jews make is a covenant with death and with hell, which is the fourth rider of the four horses of the apocalypse. And Isaiah, turn to Isaiah 28. Isaiah 28, and we're going to look in verse starting in 15. Isaiah 28, 15 through 18. This is the covenant that Daniel talks about in Daniel 9, 27. Isaiah 28, 15 through 18, this is the covenant that the Jews will make with Antichrist. Starting in verse 15, "Because ye have said, we have made a covenant with death, and with hell are we at agreement. When the overflowing scourge shall pass through, it shall not come unto us. For we have made lies our refuge, and under falsehood have we hid ourselves. Therefore, thus saith the Lord God, behold, I lay in Zion for a foundation a stone, a tried stone, a precious cornerstone, a sure foundation." This is Jesus. "He that believeth shall not make haste. Judgment also will I lay to the line," Antichrist, "and righteousness to the plummet. And the hail shall sweep away the refuge of lies, and the waters shall overflow the hiding place." In Job chapter, I think it's 38, God talks about the treasures of the hail that he has reserved unto the day of judgment. Well, here it is in Isaiah 28, talking about the hail shall sweep away the refuge of lies, and the water shall overflow the hiding place. "And your covenant with death shall be disannulled at the second coming, and your agreement with hell shall not stand. When the overflowing scourge shall pass through, then ye shall be trodden down by it." Now, turn to Luke 21. And I'm going to give you guys, especially Jeanette, a little bit of a workout tonight with all these Bible verses. Luke 21, starting in verse 20. Luke 21, 20. "And when ye shall see Jerusalem compassed about with armies, then know that the desolation thereof is nigh. Then let them which are in Judea flee to the mountains, and let them which are in the midst of it depart out, and let not them that are in the countries enter thereinto. For these be the days of vengeance, the time of Jacob's trouble, the great tribulation, that all things which are written may be fulfilled." Now, I want to draw your attention to Luke 21, 21. And this is something that happened yesterday, and it's going to send a little bit of a chill down your spine. At least it did for me. This is really, really cool. Luke 21, 21 says, "Then let them which are in Judea flee to the mountains, and let them which are in the midst of it depart out, and let not them that are in the countries enter thereinto." So in Luke 21, and Matthew says the same thing in Matthew 24, Jesus is talking and he's warning the Jews that live in Judea that it's going to be time to flee when they realize that they've been following Antichrist. Now, we don't use the term Judea today. We use the term the West Bank. And it's not owned by Israel. It is claimed by the Palestinians. So, in order for Matthew 24 and in order for Luke 21 to be fulfilled, you have to have Jews, a lot of Jews, a majority of Jews, not just a few people camped out in tents or a couple of small settlements, but in order for Matthew 24 and Luke 21 to be fulfilled, you have to have Jews living in Judea. But Judea and Samaria is what they call the West Bank, which is currently under occupation, if you will, of the by the Palestinians. On Saturday, this is yesterday, we did a story. I just put it into the chat room. If you're not in the chat room, you can go to nowtheendbegins.com and read it for yourself. This is what Israeli Prime Minister Netanyahu said yesterday. We are in the middle of the process of mapping out territory that will be part of Israel according to the Trump peace plan. It won't take much time. In a few weeks, it is going to happen. And Netanyahu said about the land, it's 800 square kilometers. It's a lot of land. He says, we have been waiting since 1967 to reclaim this land. And it's going to happen in a few weeks. He concluded with his statement by saying, President Trump will do it. I trust him completely. This is yesterday. Netanyahu said that they are planning in 1 month from yesterday, they are going to annex Judea, which is in the West Bank. They're also going to take a shot at Samaria because Judea and Samaria are, that's the land that we now call the West Bank. And Netanyahu says, this is our homeland. This is our identity. This is our heritage. And here is our future. He says, I am happy that the American policy changed under Trump's courageous leadership, starting with canceling the Iran deal, recognizing Jerusalem as the capital of Israel, moving the U.S. embassy, recognizing our sovereignty in the Golan, and recognizing the settlements in Judea and Samaria. This happened yesterday. Now, it didn't dawn on me right away until I'm going to the Bible to grab the Bible verse to put at the top of the article, which, you know, if you read these articles, I always do. And so I went to Matthew 24, verses 14 through 17. But when ye shall see the abomination of desolation, spoken of by Daniel the prophet, stand where it ought not, let him that readeth understand, then let them which be in Judea flee to the mountains. And then, and this occurred to me while I'm doing the article about what Netanyahu said yesterday, and it's like you could have knocked me over with a feather. The Jews are annexing Judea because they don't know why they're doing this, but according to the scriptures, they have to be in Judea for the time of Jacob's trouble, just like they had to be regathered so they could be scattered. People used to say to me that God regathered the Jews in 1948 and they'll never be scattered ever again. But that's not true. They're going to be scattered. Jerusalem is going to be nearly destroyed. God did not restore the Jews in 1948, because if he had restored them, there would be no tribulation coming. But God regathered the Jews in 1948 so that the prophecies of their being scattered could be fulfilled. Does that make sense to everybody? They were regathered to be scattered. And when you let that thought sink into your head, that is an amazing, amazing thought. So, just like God had to regather the Jews so that they could be scattered during the time of Jacob's trouble, Netanyahu and Israel and President Trump is helping them to do it. They are going to annex in March Judea. According to Netanyahu, he said this yesterday, they're going to annex Judea so that, and we know this, so that they can be in Judea so that Luke 21 and Matthew 24 can be fulfilled. And if that doesn't send a chill down your spine, I don't know what will. Happened yesterday. So to me, that's very, very exciting. Very exciting. We need to take a quick break, but we are just getting started. Don't go anywhere. Don't touch that dial. We will be right back in 3 minutes and 26 seconds. Don't go anywhere. Saved by the blood of the crucified one. And That is something, if you were born again in Jesus Christ, you were, there's only one way to do it. You've got to have your sins paid for by that shed blood. There's no other way. There's no other way to get up and to get in than through the blood. Jesus said, any other way is you're a thief and a robber. There's only one way to come in, and that's through the shed blood of the Lamb. All right. Right before the break, we were talking about Prime Minister Netanyahu yesterday announcing plans to annex the land of Judea and Samaria that we call the West Bank. And he's doing it. We know why he's doing it, even if he doesn't know why he's doing it. But they're doing it so that they can be in the right place at the right time when the time of Jacob's trouble leading into the Great Tribulation happens. Okay, so in the first half an hour, we set the table completely. We rightly divided everything. We talked about the time of Jacob's trouble, the first half, the Great Tribulation, the second half. Now let's talk about the days of Lot and the days of Noah. Turn to Luke chapter 17. Turn to Luke chapter 17, and we're not going to reference Matthew 24 because we already talked about that. But let's look in Luke chapter 17, and let's see what the days of Noah and the days of Lot are referencing. So Luke chapter 17, and let's start reading in verse 22. And we're going to read all the way down to verse 30. Luke 17, 22 through 30. And he said unto the disciples, the days will come when ye shall desire to see one of the days of the Son of Man, and ye shall not see it. And they shall say to you, see here, or see there. Go not after them, nor follow them. For as the lightning that lighteth out of one part under heaven shineth unto the other part under heaven, so shall also the Son of Man be in his day. But first he must suffer many things, and be rejected of this generation. And as it was in the days of Noah, so shall it be also in the days of the Son of Man. They did eat, and they drank, they married wives, they were given in marriage, until the day that Noah entered into the ark, and the flood came and destroyed them all. Likewise also, verse 28, as it was in the days of Lot, they did eat, and they drank, they bought, they sold, they planted, they builded. But the same day that Lot went out of Sodom, it rained fire and brimstone from heaven and destroyed them all. Even thus shall it be when the Son of Man is revealed. Now, there's multiple things that we need to talk about right off the bat of this section, Luke 17, 22 through 20, through 30. First thing is, you will see Jesus talking about himself, and he's calling himself the Son of Man. We read in other places, he calls himself the Son of God. Now, it's the same person, but the context is different. When we see Jesus being referenced as the Son of Man, he is speaking primarily and sometimes exclusively to a Jewish, non-Gentile audience. When we see Jesus being referred to as the Son of God, he is being put in front of primarily a Gentile audience, not a Jewish audience. So Paul talks about the Son of God, and but the Gospels talk about the Son of Man. And when you see Jesus being called the Son of Man, you know that it's a Jewish context. We have said many times, Matthew 24, there's nothing, there's no Christian church in Matthew 24. There's no Christian church in Luke 17. There's no Christian church in Acts chapter 2. they wouldn't be called Christians until Acts chapter 11. So context is key. People say, well, you just can't rightly divide according to your feelings, and we don't. We rightly divide according to the context. And the context will keep you straight every time. Once you remove the context, then you're in big trouble. And then you have no idea what you're rightly dividing. So you always have to keep your context in your head. Now, Susie has a question. Why are the Jews told Son of Man? And why are the is the church told the Son of God? Because the Jewish people are waiting for the kingdom of heaven. They are waiting for a king to come and rule over them. The kingdom of heaven is a literal, visible, physical, earthly kingdom, which will last for 1,000 years, and it's going to take place in the nation of Israel, in the capital of Jerusalem, with King Jesus sitting on the throne of David. That's what the Jewish people are waiting for. In Acts chapter 1, just hold your place in Luke 17 because we're coming right back to it. Turn to Acts chapter 1 and look at what the apostles say to Jesus right before he ascends back up into heaven. Acts chapter 1, verse 6. Acts 1, 6. When they therefore were come together, they asked of him, saying, Lord, will thou at this time restore the kingdom to Israel? They're not looking for heaven. They're not looking for the new Jerusalem. They're not looking for mansions on the street of gold. They're waiting for the king to come and give them the kingdom, which the Bible calls the kingdom of heaven. So in that kingdom, Jesus is the king over the Jewish people. And we understand this not to be a metaphor, but it's going to be literally fulfilled at the second coming, when Jesus, when we return with Jesus on white horses, Revelation 19, 14, and Jesus returns as king, but he's not our king. He's not our king at all. What is Jesus Christ to the born-again believer? We talked about this last week, actually. The Apostle Paul says that he longs to present us, the church, 2 Corinthians 11, verse 2. 2 Corinthians 11, verse 2. For I am jealous over you with a godly jealousy, for I have espoused you to one husband, that I may present you as a chaste virgin to Christ. So we aren't waiting for the kingdom of heaven. We're waiting for the kingdom of God, which, in fact, we are already in. Paul says that we are part of his body from the moment that we get saved. So when Jesus returns, Jesus is the king of the kingdom of heaven. He's also the king of the kingdom of God, a spiritual kingdom. When he returns, both those kingdoms will be in the same place at the same time. Revelation says that we rule as kings and priests with Jesus Christ for 1,000 years, but the remnant Jews and the remnant Gentiles that make it through the Great Tribulation, they're going to be repopulating the world for 1,000 years, starting in Israel when Jesus returns at the second coming. So a lot of different things in that answer. I hope that, Susie, I hope that answered your question. But that's the separation. That's the separation. Now, you will notice in Matthew, Mark, and Luke that when Jesus was teaching the Jews in Matthew, Mark, and Luke, he often spoke as of the kingdom of heaven and the kingdom of God in the same context. Because when Jesus came, he offered both those kingdoms to the Jewish people. Remember, Jesus said, I am sent not but for the lost sheep of the house of Israel. And when the Syrophoenician woman, and she's begging Jesus for that miracle, and what did Jesus say? He said, it is not meet to give the children's food to the dogs. And the woman said, yes, master, but even the dogs get to eat the crumbs that fall from the children's table. But Jesus was offering both of those kingdoms to the Jewish people, but they blew it in Acts chapter 7, and then the kingdoms were split. Paul becomes the apostle over the kingdom of God, which is the spiritual kingdom, and the kingdom of heaven gets put on hold so far for about 2,000 years. But when that pre-tribulation rapture happens, guess what God's going to turn his attention back to? He's going to turn his attention back to Israel, back to the Jewish people, and you're going to have the seven-year time of Jacob's trouble. The last half is going to be the Great Tribulation, and at the end of that, at the second coming, at the Battle of Armageddon, return with Jesus Christ on white horses, and both kingdoms are in the same place at the same time. Remember I showed you that verse last week? Turn to Luke chapter 12. Turn to Luke chapter 12 and look all the way down. Luke chapter 12, verse 36. Luke 12, 36. And ye yourselves, like unto men that wait for their Lord, when he will return from the wedding, Revelation 19, that when he cometh and knocketh, they may open unto him immediately. That's your 10 virgins from Matthew 25. So Luke 12, 36 shows that when Jesus returns at the second coming, he is already married. And guess what? He's returning with us, his bride. Now, if you can't get excited about that, there's something wrong. But that's exactly what's going to happen. All right, let's get back to Luke chapter 17, because we got some more nuggets we need to dig up. Luke 17, 26. Luke 17, 26. And as it was in the days of Noah, So shall it be also in the days of the Son of Man. Now, I want you to look at that word Noe, because that confuses a lot of people. People say to me, why don't they just say Noah? Well, because in the Old Testament, which was written in Hebrew and Aramaic, when we transliterate the word that we say is Noah, N-O-A-H, that comes from the Hebrew language. But when you go to the New Testament, which was written in Greek, the word that means Noah is now spelled differently because it's a different language. So Noah, N-O-A-H, is a Old Testament Hebrew reference. Noe, N-O-E, still the same person, it's still the guy who built the boat. Noe is Noah, but in Greek. So, just a tiny little thing for you there, but just in case you were wondering about that. Noah, Noe, same person, but the difference is Noah is in the Hebrew, and Noe, N-O-E, is in the Greek. Just like talking about the prophet Elijah. In the Old Testament, he's called Elijah, E-L-I-J-A-H. In the New Testament, same person is called Elias, E-L-I-A-S. Same person, but the difference again is the difference between Hebrew and Greek. So in Luke 17, if you were paying attention, and I know you were, in Luke 17, you see in verse 26, and as it was in the days of Noah, so shall it be also in the days of the Son of Man. We know it's a Jewish context. There's no church here. But then look at verse 28, Luke 17, 28. Likewise, also as it was in the days of Lot, they did eat, they drank, they bought, they sold, they planted, they builded. But the same day that Lot went out of Sodom, it rained fire and brimstone from heaven and destroyed them all. Now, This is pretty cool, so pay attention to this. Matthew 24 says the days of Noah. Matthew, for whatever reason, doesn't mention the days of Lot. Luke, on the other hand, mentions what Matthew mentioned. He mentions the days of Noah, and Luke throws in the days of Lot. Now, if we were just to look at that very topically and very carelessly and without really digging for anything, we would just think that that was a literary allusion. He's just, you know, the days of Noah, the days of Lot, whatever. But no, there is a very specific reason why Luke adds the days of Lot, because the two events are separate events. Think about what happened in the days of Noah. They built a boat, and the saved people got into the ark, which is a type of Jesus Christ, and that ark went up, 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 and it landed on Mount Ararat in Turkey. It went up, 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 and all the people who were left behind were destroyed. That's what happened in the days of Noah. But what happened in the day of Lot, the opposite happened. In the days of Lot, Lot and his two daughters, they stayed, and everybody else was taken out, and the people in Sodom and Gomorrah, they were destroyed by fire and brimstone from heaven. So do you see what happened there? In the days of Noah, Noah and his family were removed and taken up in a type of the rapture. But in the days of Lot, Lot and his family were not removed, but the bad people were removed. You see how that works? So you have the days of Noah at the start of the time of Jacob's trouble, and at the end of the Great Tribulation, you have the days of Lot. And that's why Luke adds the days of Lot to the days of Noah. And when we look at this from a complete perspective of the time of Jacob's trouble, remember, the first 3.5 years is the false peace and safety from 1 Thessalonians 5. And the second 3.5 years is the time of the judgments and the seals and the bowls and the trumpets and the vials. So, in the days of Noah, the righteous people were removed in a type of the rapture. In the days of Lot, in the time of the Great Tribulation, the righteous people stay and the wicked people are removed. So Luke wasn't just talking. He's giving you both ends of the 7-year time period of the time of Jacob's trouble. Isn't that amazing? I'll say it one more time just because I just like to say it. The days of Noah start, if you're going to kind of lay it as a superimposed image, right? Let's say that we're in a classroom setting and I have the overhead projector, and I have a transparency. At the start of the time of Jacob's trouble, you have the flood of Noah, which is a type of the righteous people being removed and taken up to the mountaintop, and the wicked people are destroyed. And at the end of the Great Tribulation, 7 years later, you have the righteous people staying and the wicked people being removed. Now, I don't know about you, but that gives really, really, really good harmony to the entire layout. And it shows you that, yes, there is a rapture for the church. We call it the pre-tribulation rapture. That's at the beginning of the days of Noah. And there's a rapture at the end of the Great Tribulation. But they are not the same. In The first half of the start of the time of Jacob's trouble, the righteous are removed. At the end of the Great Tribulation, 7 years later, the righteous stay and the wicked are removed. So that's why when you look at Luke 17 and he adds that days of Lot, he's giving you the second half of the equation. Now we have perfect harmony. So turn to Genesis chapter 5 and let's take a look at the days of Noah. Now, if everything that we're talking about is on track and on key, then we would see somewhere in the days of Noah, we would see a type of the pre-tribulation happening before the flood takes place. Now, certainly Noah and his family are a type of righteous people being removed as the tribulation rages below them. And that is a wonderful picture of the pre-tribulation rapture of the church. But God gives us a second one as well, which is actually the primary one. Turn to Genesis chapter 5 and look down in, we're going to look at verses 21 through 24. Genesis 5, 21 through 24. And Enoch lived 65 years and begat Methuselah. And Enoch walked with God after he begat Methuselah 300 years and begat sons and daughters. And all the days of Enoch were 365 years. And Enoch walked with God, and he was not, for God took him. The word rapture, in the Greek it's harpazo, in the Latin it's rapturos, and it means to seize by force. You will notice that Enoch was not asked if he wanted to come home with God. The Bible said Enoch was not, for God took him. That is the very definition of the word rapture, to be seized by force. Now, Jude gives us a wonderful picture. Turn to Jude in your New Testament, and we don't need to go to the book of Enoch. We just go to the book of Jude if you want to know who Enoch is. Genesis doesn't say much about Enoch other than the fact that he started having children when he was 65 years old, and he had children for 300 years, and then he was raptured. But Jude, he gives us a little bit about Enoch, which is pretty good, actually. Turn to Jude chapter 1, the only chapter, and let's look at verses 14 and 15. Jude 1, 14 and 15. And Clay just pointed out that Enoch lived for 365 years, and in the Gentile calendar, we have 365 days, which is different from the Jewish calendar of 360 days. And he's kind of making my point for me, but that's an excellent point to make, is that Enoch is a type of the Gentile who gets saved in a rapture before the tribulation. So Jude 1, 14 and 15. Jude 1, 14 and 15. And Enoch also, the seventh from Adam, prophesied of these, saying, Behold, the Lord cometh with 10,000s of his saints to execute judgment upon all, and to convince all that are ungodly among them of all their ungodly deeds which they have ungodly committed, and of all their hard speeches which ungodly sinners have spoken against him. So Jude 1, 14 and 15, what do we see about Enoch? Enoch was a preacher. Enoch was a prophet. God gave a vision to Enoch. And what did Enoch see? He saw Revelation 19. Behold, the Lord cometh with 10,000s of his saints to execute judgment. Turn to Revelation 19. Turn to Revelation 19. And Clay, I'm very glad that you pointed that out. I love when you guys pop up with stuff like that. So Thank you. I appreciate that. Revelation 19. What do we see down in, well, let's go verses 11 through 14. Well, 11 through 15. Revelation 19, 11 through 15. This is what Enoch saw. John's talking, and I saw heaven opened, and behold, a white horse, and him that sat upon him was called Faithful and True. And in righteousness he does judge and make war. His eyes were as a flame of fire, and on his head were many crowns, and he had a name written that no man knew but he himself. And he was clothed with a vesture dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God. And the armies, that's us. Paul says that he has called us to be soldiers. He said, Paul says, endure hardness as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. Why is Paul calling Christian soldiers, onward Christian soldiers? Because of Revelation 19:14. And the armies which were in heaven followed him upon white horses, clothed in fine linen, white and clean. And out of his mouth goeth a sharp sword, that with it he should smite the nations, and shall rule them with a rod of iron, and he treadeth the winepress of the fierceness and the wrath of Almighty God. Now we have to take a quick break, but when we come back, Genesis 6 giants, we're going to be looking at that. And it's, as you can see, we are setting the table very, very, very nicely. We are going to look at the Genesis 6 giants when we get back, so don't go anywhere.
Hey!
And we are back for the exciting half-hour wrap-up of tonight's program. If you're just tuning in, we are talking about the Genesis 6 giants, the days of Noah, the days of Lot, and the pre-tribulation rapture of the church. In the last half hour, we saw the exciting overview that Luke gives us in Luke 17, the days of Noah. That's when the righteous were taken up and out, and the wicked were judged. They were left behind. And then we looked at the days of Lot, where the righteous stayed and the wicked were removed. And that's exactly what we see in the time of Jacob's trouble leading in to the time of the Great Tribulation. Now, in Genesis, let's turn to Genesis chapter 6. We spent a lot of time in the last half an hour, and we were talking about the days of Lot. Now, let's take a look at the days of Noah. Genesis chapter 6. Now, we talked about Enoch. He was taken by God. He was taken by force. And we saw that Jude says that Enoch was a prophet. He had a vision of the second coming with the church returning on white horses. He saw King Jesus returning to give judgment to this world. And that's exactly what happens at the Battle of Armageddon at the second coming. And that is what Jude says that Luke saw. Says that Enoch saw, and that the rapture of Enoch precedes the days of Noah. So we add Enoch and his one-man rapture. The prophet, well, he prophesied, so we can safely call Enoch an Old Testament prophet because he prophesied for sure. And God takes him, and then in Genesis 6, we read this. And it came to pass, when man began to multiply in the face of the earth, and daughters were born unto them, that the sons of God saw the daughters of men that were fair, and they took wives of all which they chose. And the Lord said, My spirit shall not always strive with man, for he also is flesh, yet his days shall be 120 years. There were giants in the earth in those days. And also after that, when the sons of God came into the daughters of men and bare children unto them, the same became mighty men, which were of old, men of renown. And they were wicked men. Look at verse 5. And God saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every imagination of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. And then God decides he's going to destroy these giants. And it repented the Lord that he had made man on the earth, and it grieved him at his heart. Now, here is the first mention of giants. It is the word nephilim. It is from the Hebrew, and this is what it means. It means rebels, apostates, fallers, fallen ones. It is the Hebrew word which, when we transliterate it into English, we transliterate it as Nephilim. And I just put that into the chat room. I think it went. Maybe it didn't go. There we go. That's the Hebrew word for Nephilim. And that word appears in only two places in the Bible. And this is going to bring up something else that's very interesting. Genesis 6:4 says there were giants in the earth in those days. And we just read that passage. And then in Numbers 13:33. And there we saw the giants, Nephilim, the sons of Anak, which come of the giants, Nephilim, and we were in our own sight as grasshoppers, and so we were in their sight. So the word Nephilim appears three times in your King James Bible, but there is a second word, which means giants, called Rephaim, R-E-P-H-A-I-M. the Hebrew word Rapha. So, in all the other places in your King James Bible, when it talks about giants, it is talking about Rephaim. There is even a valley of Rephaim. In Genesis 14:5, we see that the Rephaims are there and they are killed. They are in league with the Hittites and the Perizzites and the Rephaims. We also find the Rephaims, these giants in the land that Joshua sent the spies out and God told them to take the land. So these giants, you always find these giants, of which Goliath was not a Nephilim. Goliath was a Rephaim. And we're going to talk about the difference between those two words in a moment. Remember, Nephilim only appears three times in your King James Bible, in Genesis 6:4 and twice in Numbers 13:33. All the other places, there's 24 other places where the word giants appear, including Goliath and his brothers. They are not Nephilim, they are Rephaim. So, we're going to talk in just a minute why that is important to know, because Dr. Ruckman used to say all the time, things that are different are not the same. Just like people think that the kingdom of God and the kingdom of heaven are the same thing. They're not the same thing. They're called two different things because they are two different things. And Nephilim and Rephaim, they're similar, but they are not the same. Now, I want to go back to Genesis chapter 6 for a moment, and I want to read verses 1 and 2 again. Genesis 6, verses 1 and 2. And it came to pass when man began to multiply on the face of the earth, and daughters were born unto them, that the sons of God saw the daughters of men, that they were fair, and they took them wives of all which they chose. Now, a lot of people have a lot of different thoughts as to who these sons of God might be. Doesn't John say in his epistles, he says, "Beloved, now are we the sons of God, and it doth not yet appear what we shall be, but we know that when he shall appear, we shall see him as he is, for we shall be like him." And John, he so beautifully calls all the born-again believers the sons of God, right? Well, that is one group of people called the sons of God. That's me and you, if you're born again today. But turn to Job chapter 1. And let's see another group of sons of God who are not human beings and who do not live on earth. Job chapter 1. And we're going to read verse 6 and 7. Job 1, verses 6 and 7. Now there was a day when the sons of God came to present themselves before the Lord, and Satan came also among them. And the Lord said unto Satan, "Whence comest thou?" Then Satan answered the Lord and said, "Well, from going to and fro in the earth and from walking up and down in it." That is Job 1, 6, and 7. Now obviously, this scene is taking place in heaven. These sons of God are created beings. They are not begotten beings. Nobody gave birth to these sons of God. These are angels. And we see them standing before God, and then we see Satan, who has access to heaven, to the throne room of God. He has access to these sons of God, which are the angels, and God and Satan get into this classic conversation. But now that we've established who these sons of God are in the book of Job, go back to Jude for a second and let's look at the passage that we didn't talk about. Jude chapter 1, and let's look at verses 5 through 7. Jude 1, 5 through 7. I will put you, therefore, in remembrance, though ye once knew this, how that the Lord, having saved the people out of the land of Egypt, afterward destroyed them that believe not. And the angels, which kept not their first estate, but left their own habitation, he has reserved in everlasting chains under darkness unto the judgment of the great day. Even as Sodom and Gomorrah, and the cities about them in like manner, giving themselves over to fornication, and going after strange flesh, and are set forth for an example, suffering the vengeance of eternal fire. Now, Clay just said Jude is amazing, and that's a great, Jude is amazing, and in fact, there is so much here in one chapter, the only chapter of the book of Jude, and Clay said Jude is amazing because Jude packs so much stuff into his one chapter that it is just incredible what you can pull out of just one chapter of the book of Jude. So here we see in verses 5 through 7, now I want you to pay attention to this. Jude says that there are angels, verse 6, that did not keep their first estate, which is heaven, but left their own habitation. The Bible tells us in Isaiah that Satan takes a third of the angels with him. And it says they have left their own habitation, and like Sodom and Gomorrah, they, the angels, gave themselves over to fornication, going after strange flesh. What was the strange flesh that the angels went after? Human women. Now, we know that every time an angel appears in the Bible, that angel appears as a man with no wings, and it looks like a regular human being. The book of Hebrews says, and let me just turn there for a second. The book of Hebrews talks about angels, and it says, it actually has a lot to say about angels, and where is that verse about angels unawares? Where is that verse? But that is a really, really good verse because Hebrews 13:2, be not forgetful to entertain strangers, for thereby some have entertained angels unawares. Hebrews 13:2. Now, you think about it, how could you be entertaining an angel and not know it? Because the angel looks just like a man. And every time an angel shows up in the Bible, what does it look like? There's no wings. They look like men. So that's why Paul says in Hebrews 13:2, be not forgetful to entertain strangers, for thereby some have entertained angels unawares. So angels look like men. I am not saying that I believe there are no female angels. I am saying that in the Bible, every time you see an angel, it's a man and there's no wings. So, could there be female angels? There absolutely could be. Does the Bible mention them? The Bible does not. Every example the Bible gives us is of a man with no wings. So, why is all this important? Go back to Genesis chapter 6. Now, we've established, I just showed you the sons of God from Job chapter 1, and I showed you that they're right up there with God and Satan, and everybody is all kind of all out in the open. Everybody is kind of interacting with everybody else. Then we went to the book of Jude, and we saw that angels left heaven, and they went after strange flesh, strange for angels, which would be human women. And then we get back to where we started, Genesis chapter 6. And it came to pass when man began to multiply on the earth and daughters were born unto them, that the sons of God from Job chapter 1 saw the daughters of men, the strange flesh from the book of Jude, that they were fair, and took them wives of all which they chose. And then, two verses later, what pops up? There were giants in the earth in those days. Now, I told you that there's only two places in the Bible where it talks about giants that uses the word Nephilim. That's Genesis 6:4. Numbers 13:33 mentions it twice. But there's 24 other places where the word giants is used. And every single one of those, for example, turn to Deuteronomy 3, turn to Deuteronomy 3:11. And this is one of my favorite verses about the giants. And it talks about that bed that's 13 feet long. What would it be like to sleep in a bed that was 13 feet long? You would only, if you were a 6 foot tall person, and I'm right around 5'11", if I was to sleep in a bed that was 13 feet long, my feet wouldn't even hit the middle if my head was on the pillow. And yet, there was a giant, they called him Og, and he was the king of Bashan, and he slept in a bed that was 13 feet long. Deuteronomy 3:11, for only Og, king of Bashan, remained in the remnant of giants. Behold, his bedstead was a bedstead of iron, is it not, in Rabbath of the children of Ammon? 9 cubits was the length thereof, and 4 cubits the breadth of it, after the cubit of a man. So what's interesting is that this is a really long bed, but it's not proportionately wide. I'll say that one more time. It's a really long bed, but it's not proportionately wide. A cubit is roughly 18 inches, okay? So 18 times 9 is 162 divided by 12 equals 13.5 feet long. But Moses tells us that it's 4 cubits wide. So it's 18 times 4 equals 72 divided by 12, 6. So this bed for Og, the king of Bashan, is 13.5 feet long, but it's only 6 feet wide. Now you would think, right, that if it was 13 and a half feet long, why wouldn't this bed be at least 8, 9, 10 feet wide? But it's a long, thin bed. Why? Because the king is roughly 12 to 13 feet tall. That's how big this king is. But the word used for giants is not Nephilim, it is the word Rephaim. Now, I had said earlier that we were going to talk about the difference between Nephilim and Rephaim, even though both words are used as giants. But before we do, turn to, I just had it. Where is that? Well, turn to 1 Chronicles 20, verse 6. Turn to 1 Chronicles 20, verse 6. And yet again there was war at Gath, where was a man of great stature, whose fingers and toes were 24, 6 on each hand and 6 on each foot, and he was the son of a giant. That's 1 Chronicles 20, verse 6. And he says that this man with 6 fingers on each hand and 6 toes on each foot, and he was the son of a giant, of a Rephaim. Now, what's the difference between the Nephilim and the Rephaim? Rephaim is mentioned 24 times. Nephilim is mentioned three times in two verses. Here's the difference. The Nephilim refer to the fallen angels, and angels are pretty big. The word Nephilim means one who has fallen. And it is the Nephilim that have sex with the human women. And their offspring, their children, are the Rephaim. So even though the word Nephilim and Rephaim are both used in the context of giants, when you see Nephilim in two places, Genesis 6:4 and Numbers 13:33, that is referring to the parents who fathered the children who became the giants, which are the Rephaim. And that's the difference between Nephilim and Rephaim, even though that they are both used to denote giants. The Nephilim refers to the fallen angels who gave birth to the children who became the giants, which the Bible says are the Rephaim. Look that word up sometime, Rephaim, the Valley of Rephaim. It's all over the Old Testament. And every place that you see the Rephaim popping up, and every place that you see the Rephaim popping up, guess who they are the enemy of? They're the enemy of the Jewish people every time. Goliath was a Rephaim. Goliath was an enemy of the Jewish people. He was a Philistine. And he had four brothers. And David had five smooth stones in his slingshot. Goliath and his brothers were Rephaim. Every place Rephaim shows up, they are the arch enemy of the Jewish people every single time. Now, we have 5 minutes left. Let me just put a bow on this thing and wrap it all up for you. Jesus is talking about the time of Jacob's trouble, leading into the time of the Great Tribulation. And he says it's going to be like the days of Noah, and it's going to be like the days of Lot. The days of Noah include the rapture of Enoch, who was a prophet and a preacher. It includes Noah and his family as a type of the righteous who are taken up and removed. And I just remembered one more verse. Turn to Song of Solomon chapter 2. Turn to Song of Solomon chapter 2, and this one will put a little bit of chill in your spine as well. Song of Solomon chapter 2, starting in verse 8 through 10. The voice of my beloved, behold, he come leaping upon the mountains, skipping upon the hills. My beloved is like a roe or a young hart. Behold, he standeth behind our wall. He looketh at the windows, showing himself through the lattice. My beloved spake and said unto me, rise up, my love, my fair one, and come away. So there we see a type of the pre-tribulation rapture in the Song of Solomon. And what happened when Noah and his family were taken up in the ark, which is a type of Jesus Christ? They were taken up while the wicked were destroyed. Those giants were not all of them, obviously, but the vast majority of them. And then Luke directs our attention to, yes, it's going to be like the days of Noah, but it's also going to be like the days of Lot, when Lot and his family were not taken away, but the wicked were taken away. And isn't it interesting how Jude ties the fallen angels in with Sodom and Gomorrah? Luke ties the Great Tribulation in with Sodom and Gomorrah. Genesis chapter 6 ties it in with Sodom and Gomorrah. So here we have harmony, that we see that the time of Jacob's trouble leading into the time of the Great Tribulation, it's going to start out with the days of Noah, which includes a rapture, Enoch. the taking away of the righteous up to the mountaintop, judgment for those left behind, and then at the end, the righteous stay, the wicked go, the king returns with the body of Christ, and we have him ruling and reigning for 1,000 years. I hope this program was a blessing to you. This is just one of those programs. It's just exciting. It makes the Bible feel like it was just written yesterday. It's just so exciting, and there is so much to learn. But do you see how everything was so beautifully connected, and that we have complete harmony, and we see that the days of Noah and the days of Lot contain everything from the pre-tribulation rapture of the church to the rise of Antichrist, false peace, false safety, the bowl seal and the judgments and all those things that are happening, and then the righteous being saved but not removed at the second coming. Please share this. If this program was a blessing to you, please grab the link and share it with some friends on social media. I thank you so much for tuning in. And Lord willing, we'll see you right back here, same time next week. Good night, everybody.